Hello everyone, welcome to Pragya Biology classes. This is Dr. Shal Pragya and today we will talk about plant life where we will discuss about photosynthesis. In this video, we will talk about definition of photosynthesis, basic process. Then we will discuss about importance of photosynthesis, site of photosynthesis, why are plants green, light dependent reactions and light independent reactions that we will not discuss in very detail. Then we will discuss factors affecting photosynthesis and then we will discuss different experiments to demonstrate photosynthesis process, different setups, and then we will conclude the video. Dear students, photosynthesis is the process of using light energy to convert water and carbon dioxide into sugar and oxygen. And this occurs in all the autotrophs. Now, what is autotrophs? Autotrophs are the organism that have the ability to synthesize food by the process of photosynthesis. In other words, we can say that it occurs in plants. And not only in plants, it also occurs in algae and some prokaryotes. Next, we will discuss about importance of photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is very important for all the organisms present on this earth because sun's energy is converted into utilizable forms of energy during this process. This is the process that most biological organisms are unable to perform. Only green plants are having capability to convert light energy into the chemical energy. So, it converts light energy into chemical energy in the form of glucose, and then the glucose is utilized by all the organisms to produce ATP, and this ATP gives the organisms energy. Photosynthesis also participates in carbon dioxide removal. In other words, we can say that photosynthesis converts carbon dioxide into oxygen. During photosynthesis, carbon dioxide leaves the atmosphere and enters the plant and leaves the plant as oxygen. So, this is a process which is ecologically and environmentally important in nature. When the solar energy is transformed by photosynthesis, is the source of countless vegetables, animals and organic side products. Wood is very important material used as fuel and in many fields including constructions like that paper, cotton and other natural fibers consists of cellulose produced almost entirely by photosynthesizing plants. Like that, many animals are also dependent on photosynthesis for the energy. Next, we will discuss about sites of photosynthesis. Photosynthesis occurs in chloroplast, and chloroplast is the organelles that is present in all the green plants. Chloroplasts are present in the green plants and carry out photosynthesis that we all know. The leaves have the most chloroplast on the lower surface of the leaf. The green color comes from chlorophyll in the chloroplast and the pigment absorbs light energy. A chloroplast contains a stroma, that is a fluid, and grana, that is stacks of thylakoids. The thylakoids contain chlorophyll and chlorophyll is the green pigment that captures the light energy for photosynthesis and converts it into chemical energy. During the process of photosynthesis, carbon dioxide enters the leaf and oxygen is released to the outer atmosphere. But how does exchange of gases take place in the leaf? On the lower surface of the leaf and on green stems are present small openings called stomata. The singular is stoma. The byproduct, oxygen and water vapors are released into the air through stomata. Carbon dioxide from the air is also taken in through stomata. Now we will discuss about the structure of stomata. Each stoma is surrounded by a pair of kidney-shaped guard cells. Each guard cell is a modified epidermal cell showing a prominent nucleus, cytoplasm, and plastids. The wall of the guard cell is differentially thickened. The inner wall of each guard cell is facing the stomata, is concave, and is thick, rigid. The guard cells are surrounded by a variable number of epidermal cells called subsidiary cells. Next, we will discuss about the working of stomata. Opening and closing of stomata takes place due to changes in turgor pressure of guard cell. During the day, water from subsidiary cells enters the guard cell, making the guard cell fully turgid and the stomata open. During night time, water from guard cells enters the subsidiary cell, and as a result, the guard cells become flaccid due to decrease in turgor pressure and stomata close. The rate of photosynthesis is affected by the presence of light, wavelength, carbon dioxide concentration, temperature, water supply, chlorophyll concentration, pollution. So, we can say that in the absence of any of these factors, the rate of photosynthesis will be directly affected. Now, we will discuss all the important factors in detail. The most important factor for photosynthesis is light intensity. The rate of photosynthesis would go up as intensity is increased, because the more light a plant absorbs, the more photosynthesis can occur, which will lead to the production of more ATP. However, very high intensity slows down the rate as it bleaches the chlorophyll. Normal sunlight is quite sufficient for a normal rate of photosynthesis. Red light is most beneficial for photosynthesis. The next important factor is wavelength. Different colors of light can affect how much photosynthesis can occur, because only certain colors are absorbed. The more colors that is absorbed, the more light that is absorbed, which will lead to more photosynthesis and eventually more ATP. Photosynthesis depends upon the absorption of light by pigments in the leaves of plants. The most important of these is chlorophyll. Next important factor is carbon dioxide concentration. Concentration of carbon dioxide increases the rate of photosynthesis, but its concentration beyond a certain level decreases the rate of photosynthesis. The rate of photosynthesis is initially high at high temperature. The optimum temperature ranging from 25 degrees centigrade to 35 degrees centigrade is required for a good rate of photosynthesis. At temperatures around 0 degrees centigrade, the enzymes stop working, and at very high temperature, the enzymes are denatured. This is the graph shows the effect of temperature on the rate of photosynthesis. Next important factor is water supply. Water is an essential factor in photosynthesis. The lack of water not only causes the plant to wilt and thereby lose its ability to capture sunlight, but also limits the quantity of carbon dioxide. This happens as when the leaves are dry, they close their stomata to enter in order to conserve water being lost as water vapor through them. Not more than 1% of total water absorbed by the plant is used in photosynthesis. Even water is necessary for photosynthesis. The concentration of chlorophyll is the another important factor that affects the rate of reaction, as they absorb the light energy needed for the reactions. Lack of chlorophyll or deficiency of chlorophyll results in chlorosis or yellowing of leaves. It can occur due to disease, mineral deficiency, or the natural process of aging. Lack of iron, magnesium, nitrogen, and light affect the formation of chlorophyll, and in this way we can say that chlorophyll concentration is essential for the process of photosynthesis because it helps the plants to trap the solar energy. Next is pollution. Pollution of the atmosphere with industrial gases produces soot and blocks stomata and reduces the transparency of the leaves. Other pollutants are ozone and sulfur dioxide. In fact, lichens are very sensitive to sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere. Pollution of water affects the hydrophytes. The capacity of water to dissolve gases like carbon dioxide and oxygen is greatly affected. Next, we will discuss some experiments on photosynthesis to demonstrate photosynthesis process. Dear students, in our syllabus, we have to study only four experiments on photosynthesis. The first one is to test the need of chlorophyll for photosynthesis. Second experiment is to show that sunlight is essential for photosynthesis. The third experiment is to demonstrate that oxygen is evolved during photosynthesis, and the fourth one is to show that carbon dioxide is necessary for photosynthesis. Dear students, before studying about the experiments, we should have some pre-experimental knowledge. The test and control experiments use de-starched plant. Plants are de-starched by keeping them in the dark for 2 days. Plants are tested for the presence of starch at the end of the experiment. But why the leaves used in these experiments must not contain starch at the start? So that one can tell whether it has formed during the experiment. Dear students, 4 में से 3 एक्सपेरिमेंट में हम लोग डी-स्टार्च्ड लीव्स का यूज़ करेंगे. सो ये हम लोगों के लिए बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट हो जाता है कि हम लोग लीव को डी-स्टार्च करते क्यों हैं. इसलिए कि उस दौरान जो भी स्टार्च बने हो, ये नहीं कहा जा सके कि वह एक्सपेरिमेंट के दौरान नहीं बना है, वह पहले से ही प्रेजेंट था लीव्स में. नाउ व्हाट इज़ अ डी-स्टार्च्ड प्लांट? A plant without starch is known as de-starched plant. In the diagram, it is shown clearly. So the next question is, how is a plant de-starched? So we can de-starch a plant by leaving it in a dark room for 2 or 3 days. But what happens to the starch in the dark room? In the dark room, the starch is used for respiration. Whatever starch remain available in the plant, it is used for the respiration. But how can you tell whether photosynthesis has occurred or not? Photosynthesis hua ya nahi, yah pata chalega by testing for starch using iodine solution. Iodine solution se jaise hi hum starch ka pata chalayenge, to starch agar patti mein hogi, to leaves ke color change honge bluish black mein. Aur agar leaves ke color change nahi ho rahe hain, iska matlab hai ki starch available nahi hai aur photosynthesis nahi hua hai. Jaisa ki hum sabhi jante hain, agar photosynthesis hoga to starch formation hoga, aur agar starch formation hoga to as we know starch reacts with iodine solution and give bluish black color. Now we will demonstrate the first experiment, and the aim of that experiment is to show that carbon dioxide is necessary for photosynthesis. And for this we will take 2 plants, and these 2 plants are de-starched. The plants are watered and set up as shown. Plants are left in sunlight for 2 to 3 hours. A leaf from each plant is tested for starch. During this experiment, we take some crystals of potassium hydroxide in a petri dish and keep it near setup A plant. And we can also take sodium hydroxide instead of potassium hydroxide. Now, what is the function of soda lime or sodium hydroxide? Soda lime or sodium hydroxide absorbs carbon dioxide, whereas if we take sodium hydrogen carbonate in another setup, that means in the setup B, and if we keep the petri dish near the plant, it will release carbon dioxide. Dear students, these setups, means plant A and plant B, can be kept inside a bell jar also. After that, we pluck a leaf from each plant and test each for the presence of starch using iodine solution. For this, we boil the leaf in boiling water that stops enzymatic reactions within the cells in leaf. Put the boiled leaf in boiling tube containing alcohol, that is ethanol. Extract chlorophyll as ethanol dissolves lipid in cell membranes. Return the leaf to the hot water, softens the leaf and allows penetration of iodine. Remove leaf and perform the iodine test. We observe that the leaf from the first setup does not show any change in color, while the leaf from B setup changes color to bluish black, which shows the presence of starch in the leaf. Therefore, this experiment shows that carbon dioxide is needed for photosynthesis. The aim of the next experiment is to show that oxygen is produced during photosynthesis. Materials required: pond water, freshly cut hydrilla plant, a beaker, test tube, glass funnel, and water. Take a beaker and fill 3/4 part it with water. Take some freshly cut hydrilla twigs and insert it in a funnel through its stem. Fill a glass test tube with water and invert it over the stem of the funnel. Make sure that the level of the water in the beaker should be above the level of the stem of the inverted funnel. Keep the setup under the sunlight for a few hours. Observation: bubbles start emerging from the hydrilla plant and collect in the inverted test tube. If we remove the test tube and introduce a burning splint inside it, the splint will burn more brightly. Hydrilla plants start photosynthesis in the presence of sunlight and release oxygen. So we can conclude that oxygen is evolved during photosynthesis. Aim of the next experiment is to test the need of chlorophyll for photosynthesis. Materials required: a variegated plant, a petri dish, dilute iodine solution. For this experiment, pluck a leaf from a variegated plant which was exposed to sunlight for 5 to 6 hours. Place the leaf in a petri dish. Draw an outline on the leaf separating its green and non-green parts. Put a few drops of iodine solution on it for testing starch using those 4 steps explained previously. You will observe that the green portion of the leaf turns blue-black. The green part of the leaf shows the presence of starch in it. The green portion of the leaf appears green due to the presence of chlorophyll. In the presence of chlorophyll, photosynthesis took place in these areas, the glucose produced during photosynthesis gets stored as starch in green areas of the leaf and gives blue-black color with the iodine solution. Next, we will discuss the experiment to show that sunlight is essential for photosynthesis. Materials required: a potted plant, dilute iodine solution, paper clips, and black paper. Procedure: place a potted plant in a totally dark room for about 3 to 4 days to remove any starch from the leaves, as plants do not photosynthesize in dark room. Pluck a leaf from this plant. Now, with the help of paper clips, cover a part of the leaf by a black paper strip. Keep the potted plant in sunlight for a few hours. You will observe that the exposed part of the leaf turns blue-black, but the covered part does not turn blue-black. We can conclude that photosynthesis takes place in the presence of sunlight. Therefore, at last, we can conclude that all plants and animals are dependent on the sun for energy. This energy is made available to them by the process of photosynthesis. Man, like other animals, is dependent on the plants for his food. No photosynthesis means no life. Dear students, I hope everything would be clear to you. If you have any doubt, you can write in the comment section. Thank you for watching the video. See you very soon in my next video.